Morning.
Morning.
This morning's scripture reading will be from Hebrews chapter 4, verse 13. Neither is there any creature that is not manifest in his sight, but all things are naked and open unto the eyes of him with whom we have to do.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Another great day to come and worship our God and be in His presence. Be able to go to Him in prayer. To be able to have Him touch our hearts, and that's important. To know that we're in His presence and He's with us. Nice going on. Have you ever felt like it was just useless to do anything? Because it seemed like no matter what you did, it didn't work. No matter what you said, it wasn't right. No matter what was going on, you just got the feeling, well, why do I even try? Why do I even do it? Maybe you felt nobody cares. Wasn't going to last. The effort just wasn't worth it. I'm sure we've all been there. We've been there a lot. I mean, we live in a world that tries to beat us down constantly. And so we get depressed. We get into that kind of situation. I mean, you think about it, and I've heard this excuse. Somebody says, why do you make your bed? You're just going to eat it in again later. Why do you eat a meal? You're just going to eat another later. I mean, you think about the things that we do that's repetitious, and some of the things we do that we just feel like we're not having any success. A few years ago, Martina McBride had a song out called Anyway, and of course, said, God is great, but sometimes life ain't good. And when I pray, it doesn't always turn out like I think it should. But do it anyway. I do it anyway. See, all Christians must be motivated to do things to please God. Not to please self. Not really to please anybody else, but to please God. And so, no matter what's going on in your life, please God anyway. Today I want to look at three things that we need as Christians in our life that we need to do anyway. First, we need to learn to forgive. Forgiveness is a must. I mean, God has forgiven us. You might think, well, I tried to forgive, but it wasn't accepted. You know who else can say that? Jesus. I forgave, but they turned around and they hurt me again. Again, Jesus. I want to forgive, but they don't want to accept Jesus. You know, you think about how important forgiveness is. What does this mean? Well, it means a lot to us. When we think of our life, we think of our sin, and we think how important it is for Jesus to forgive us, we've got to think it's just as important for me to forgive those around me. In Luke chapter way, of all these protests that go on in our country about all these different things, if anybody had a right to protest, it was Jesus. I committed no sin, and I got to go die for it?
Yes.
Think about it. It seems like people are protesting things every day now about something because I wasn't treated right. And here, the very people that are nailing, that have nailed Jesus to the cross, the putting up where he says, you know, forgiveness is as important as any command as a Christian that we give. It's just as important as baptism. It's just as important as assembly. It's just as important as taking the Lord's Supper. If you look at what Jesus says in Matthew 6, 14 and 15, for if you forgive men when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive. But if you do not forgive men their sins, your heavenly Father will not forgive your sins. Forgiveness is a must for Christians. If you want to spend eternity in heaven, you must forgive. Not only that, but you can't worship properly without forgiveness. In Matthew chapter 5, verses 23 and 24, we're told if you're presenting your gift to the altar and you remember you have something against your brother, go and make it right, then come back and present your offering. You see, when we have malice in our heart, when we have something against people, we can't properly worship the God of love. We can't properly worship the God who is the creator and loves us unconditionally, who forgives us when we ask. You cannot love God without forgiveness in your heart. You can't hold grudges and say, I love God. God forgive. You see, true love does not allow for an unforgiving heart. God loves each of us so much, yet we continue to sin. I mean, it would be so nice to be able to say, yeah, once I was immersed in the waters of baptism, when I came up with a new creation, I never sinned again. Well, probably until I got out the back door. You never know. God continues to forgive us. John hits that really hard in 1 John 1. You know, he says in 1 John 1, chapter 2, you know, I write this to you so you will not sin. However, if you do, there is forgiveness available. I once saw where it said, doing an injury puts you below your enemy. Revenging an injury makes you even with the enemy. Forgiving the injury sets you above it. You see, God says, I'll take care of the problems. I'll take care of the people that abuse you. You just love. And we have to remember that forgiveness is not probation. I'll forgive that person if they never hurt me again. That's not forgiveness. God, should I forgive my brother or man? Jesus told me, 72:7. Well, does that mean Peter need to carry around the notebook with everybody's name in it and get the 490? Is that why I have to forgive them anymore? Is that what Jesus is trying to teach here? No. Say, you forgive them as often as they need it. As often as they need forgiveness, you give it to them. That's what Jesus does. I mean, think about it. Most of us in this room, most, are above what we consider middle age. You think we're past the 490? Right, past that is a teenager. Right? Isaiah chapter 55, verse 8 says, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord." God's going to do things His way, not because He's a rebel, but because He knows the right way to do things. He knows the correct way to accomplish things. And the frightening part is that when we start praying for things, many times we have to be ready to be the answer to our own prayer. I mean, when we sit down and we start praying, say, "God, I just pray that you'll guide our congregation into growth." Maybe God's telling you. Yeah, we can do that. Get involved. Do what you're called to do. Jesus was God on earth. And He prayed constantly. Was He talking to Himself? No way. He's talking to God the Father in heaven. I mean, He knew that His mission was to please God. His mission was to do what God sent Him to do. And He prayed constantly. But yet this widow kept wear me out. Even though I don't have any respect for people, even though I don't have any respect for God, I will give her justice. And look at what Jesus says in Luke 18:7. And will not God bring about justice for his chosen ones who cry out to him day and night? Will he keep putting them off? You know, the Bible isn't comparing God to this judge who didn't believe, but he's saying if someone who doesn't believe can be more down about persistence, God wants to listen to your prayer because he knows how important things are to you. He will bring about justice for his chosen ones. But then there's the fact that why didn't Jesus get what he prayed for in the garden? He prayed, this cup pass from me. Why didn't he get it? You know what? Jesus did get what he prayed for. He did. He prayed that this cup would pass through. We don't know what that cup was. We assume we're talking about the crucifixion. That's what we assume. But you know what happened? Angels came and attended him. That cup of anguish and fear went away. I mean, he told his closest friends, Peter, James, and John, my soul is troubled to the point of death. But yet, when he went back and he found his disciples sleeping again, the third time, he finally said, come on, it's time to do what I'm supposed to do. That cup of anguish and fear passed from him, and he was ready to do what he was called to do. I mean, I believe Jesus knew from the beginning there is no way for this sacrifice to happen without the blood of something innocent. So he got what he prayed for. But again, maybe not the way we thought it should have turned out. But then Jesus gives us a great promise about prayer. Matthew 7, verses 7 and 8. Ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives. He who seeks finds. And to him who knocks, the door will be opened. What better promise could we ask for? I mean, we have to pray with faith, people. We have to believe that God is able and willing to do whatever we ask because he can. Jesus said in John 14:13, and I will do whatever you ask in my name so that the Son may bring glory to the Father. And you may ask me for anything in my name and I will do it. In John 15:16, then the Father will give you whatever you ask. John 16:23, I tell you the truth. My Father will give you whatever you ask in my name. How many times does Jesus have to tell us something before we believe it? How many times does Jesus have to say something before it's true? Once. Right there, three times in John. He says, ask with faith. Ask, and you will receive it. Not that we don't believe it. We don't believe it because too many times we pray and we didn't get what we prayed for, at least in our minds. Because it didn't turn out the way we thought it should. It turned out the way that God knew that it should. You know, so the question comes down to is, do we truly believe the promises of Christ? Because if we can't believe those, how can we believe eternal life? How can we believe that we're saved? How can we believe in grace and mercy? If we don't believe in the promises of Jesus, we never lie. How can we believe in anything we read in the Bible? And you put it that way, it's kind of tough, isn't it? you can be baptized for remission of sins and sent back and watch what happens. Nowhere does it tell us that. Nowhere does it demonstrate that. If we look at it, Galatians in chapter 6 and verse 10, therefore, as they have opportunity, let us do good to all people, especially to those who belong to the family of believers. We have a responsibility as Christians to serve the world around us, our neighborhood. People will be coming into contact with, but notice he says, especially to those who belong to the family of believers. People who belong to the church, they get a little special attention. One example I always use is a church that has a food pantry. A member should never, ever, 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 ever have to go to the food pantry at the church, ever. If a member of that congregation is in need, the congregation should come together and flood them with groceries. Should give them what they need. The food pantry is for people on the outside coming in. It's kind of an outreach type of service. You know, the way we serve people, especially when we serve those that aren't part of the body, and sometimes that are, they don't always appreciate it. They don't always care. And worse, what if it's not convenient for me? What if it's a bad time? What if I got plans and somebody calls and says, look, I really need this right now? I mean, think about it. You think of people being unappreciated, it's going to happen. Jesus, when he cleansed the 10 lepers, only one came back. The thing. And that one was a Samaritan. You know, the ones that the Jews hated the Jews. The Samaritan came back to thank this Jew for cleansing him from his leprosy. And to praise God. And Jesus said in Luke 17:17, we're not all 10 cleansed. Where are the other 9? Jesus knows that 9 out of the 10 were unappreciative. But did that mean that Jesus wasn't going to serve anymore? Did he quit serving people? No. He continued to serve. He continued to heal. You know, the thing about service is it doesn't have to be something extraordinary. It doesn't have to be a major undertaking. And so many people will wait for some big thing to come along because they want to serve in a big way. There's nothing wrong with serving in a big way. But God pretty much tells us, if you can't handle the little things, you'll never get a chance to handle the big things. Serving others is basically tending to their needs. Remember the great judgment scene in Matthew chapter 25, begins around verse 31? Talks about how the king will separate the sheep to his right, the goats to his left. And he'll tell those on his right, enter into the kingdom, into the rest that was prepared for you by your Father in heaven. And they ask, what did we do to deserve this? Why did we get to go in? And Jesus gave them a list. I was hungry, you fed me. I was thirsty, you gave me drink. I was sick, you visited me. I was naked, you clothed me. I was in prison, and you came to me. And people are, so? What's that? They were the ones waiting on that big opportunity problem. They were the ones thinking, need something big to come up. Service is important. I watched my wife rub a lady's feet in the hospital for 4 hours in the emergency room one night. Service. I mean, how many people would want to do that? Not a big foot thing, especially of other people's. See, seeing a need and meeting it, that's all there is to it. That makes it easy, doesn't it? Seeing that need and meeting it. But if you look at Matthew 25:40, you know what? I'll tell you the truth. Whatever you did for one of these least of these brothers of mine, you did for me. When we serve people, we serve God. We see a need, we meet it. God knows it. Doesn't matter how big or how small it is. Pure religion includes service. Pure religion never is described in the Bible as coming to worship on Sunday morning and singing with all your heart and listening to the prayers, listening to the sermon, and shaking everybody's hands before you leave. Those things are important. Oh, yeah. I think we need to do those things. But pure religion is described in James 1:25, religion that God our Father accepts as pure and faultless as this, to look after orphans and widows in their distress. Meeting the needs of those who need. We must be driven by love to serve our brothers and to serve strangers. Oh, it's hard. It's hard. Our service isn't always going to be appreciated. Do it anyway. Family, we may very well feel that the world has rendered us useless. We must continue on in the path of righteousness anyway. We must stand in boldness that we get through God for the truth and do what's right. And our motivation should never be for what we can gain, but to please God who watches us closely. He watches over us. He guides us. He leads us. He gives us strength. He touches our hearts. And he protects us. And if you feel the world is beating you down, remember 1 John chapter 4 and verse 4. You, dear children, are from God and have overcome them, because the one who is in you is greater than the one who is in the world. God is greater than Satan. He's far more powerful. And God is victorious. God is in you. Whatever is for God, do it anyway. May not always seem like it's worth it. May not always seem like anybody cares. It may not always seem like it's working. But if it's for God, do it anyway. If you're here today and you've never been baptized for remission of sins, you have the opportunity to be immersed and come up out of the waters of a brand new creation, one without sin. Yeah, you're probably going to sin again. Baptize again. Be immersed anyway. Get that forgiveness. Clothe yourself in Christ. Christian, maybe you're struggling with a sin. Maybe you're struggling with something in your life.